Yo, what's up, world? It's your boy Fuckle Holmes, and we back with a very, very special episode of Artist Circle. We wanted to spice things up with this one and focus on the digital space of art and see what the future holds for it. The future starts with the present, so we had to find one artist who we think you definitely should watch out for in the future, or even now. Without any further ado, please welcome our next guest.
Hi, my name is Lethabo Huma, and welcome to my Artist Circle.
Perfect.
So, Lethabo, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Hope you're having a lovely day so far.
It's pretty warm, so I'm happy.
Yeah. I don't know. Onge told me you're from Cape Town. Is that right? Well, that's a different. Pretoria.
I'm from Pretoria. Oh. I love Cape Town.
Okay, cool.
But I'm from Pretoria, yes.
So, first question, Lethabo, who gave you that beautiful name?
My grandmother. She gave me all my names, actually. So, I'm Lethabo Malerato Huma. So, she's the one that named me. Yeah.
Do you relate to its meaning?
That's a very interesting question. I can relate to it in a sense that, like, I'm a very emotional person. Like, I'm very led by my emotions. Mm. So I think, like, I'm always, like, in search of, like, peace of mind, just clarity. And I think that's what happiness means to me. So, yeah, I could say in a way I am.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would you regard yourself as a shy or just a quiet person?
Shy or just a quiet person.
Yeah.
I mean, it honestly depends on the setting, but if I'm in a totally new setting and with totally new people, I can get a little quiet and shy and reserved. So it just depends on my environment, yeah.
In your friend circle, are you the only artist?
No, I'm the only professional artist. But most of my friends are creatives. Like, my best friend, she's studying law, but she's like a yoga fanatic. She's a yoga teacher. My other friend, he's like a computer scientist, but he does like generative art, which is totally cool. So yeah.
So do they inspire you, like, in some of the stuff that you work on?
Definitely. Like, mostly they inspire me to just like create and to just be like as authentic as I can through my work and in the way that I express myself. Yeah.
When in your life did you realize you can draw?
Honestly, the first time I realized that, you know, this might be for me, I was in grade zero.
What?
I was in grade north. I know, right? So, I'll just give you like a brief like thing about the story behind it. So basically, we had this teacher, Mrs. Davis. So she asked us to like draw whatever she was drawing on the board, right? Simple, sir. I took my crayons and a piece of paper and I just started drawing. It was like sort of like a spaceship with like aliens coming out of the spaceship.
Yeah.
And you know, I drew that and I looked at the board and I looked at my work and I'm like, this is so good. And I think it was the first time. I was a very quiet child, so I didn't like really like, I wasn't the child to like raise my hand or like speak loudly and stuff like that. But then it was the one time I was like, you know, I have to show this to Mrs. Davis. This is amazing. So then I went to her and I showed, and I was just so proud of myself. And I think that's when I kind of knew that, you know, I'd like, this thing actually makes me feel proud and it's something that I want to share with the world. So yeah,
that's so cool. Is digital art the only type of art you're interested in doing?
Definitely not. I experiment with a lot of like different kinds of art, but like I really love that mixture of like technology and art. Like, that's, for me, it's just amazing. But I do like experiment with other art. Like, even before I was a digital artist, like I would do sculpting. I was really into like sculpting. I was into pencil sketching, you know, painting and stuff like that. So I definitely do want to like broaden my horizons, like moving forward. But like for now, I really just want to explore this like tech art space.
Yeah.
Fully, like completely, yeah.
What type of art did you start with?
I started with pencil sketches. Yeah, like I would do like, you know, with different types of like pencils and stuff like that. That's how I started. And then I sort of like transitioned into your acrylic oil paints and stuff like that. And then that's when I landed on sculpting for a little bit, and I realized that no, this needs a lot of discipline and practice and research and stuff like that. And then in that sort of like space, then I sort of like kept on. I was in a very like, I'd say like experimental phase when I was doing like your sculpting. Like I was also doing, I remember, dried flowers. So I'd pick flowers and then I'd put them in the microwave and then I would like dry them and then like put them on paper and stuff like that. So that's also when I discovered digital art and stuff like that. So I kind of like then just stuck with digital art and just sort of like explored that space.
So you like experimenting within the space, yeah, and not just definitely sticking to one thing. From your family, who inspired you to like even want to do this life thing? Besides just the art.
Wow, like honestly, the people that inspire me to keep it going, to live, to wake up in the morning and just do whatever, I would say is my mother and my grandmother. You know, I'm pretty close to them. So I think seeing them just like continually like do this life thing on a regular basis, like every single day, just be, you know, I think, okay, let me, my mother and grandmother are very independent people. So I think them having that courage and that strength to wake up in the morning and to just get their life, I think that's what really inspires me. Like I really look up to them in that sense that I also want to be like that. You know, I also want to be that woman that wakes up in the morning and it's like, I'm gonna, you know, do whatever needs to be done for the day. You know what I mean? So yeah, definitely, I'd honestly definitely say my mother and my grandmother.
So NFTs, what led you to doing NFT art?
What led me to doing it, I kind of like had like some kind of background information on like Web3 and like the blockchain technology, just from computer science. And sort of like my friend who I studied computer science with, he was like, he called me and, you know, he told me about it. We spent like, I think, an hour just talking about NFTs, like what could this mean for the future of art and stuff like that. And I was really interested in it. And I think, you know, the more I read about it, the more I read about the technology and how it works, I saw how it could benefit specifically digital art, you know, because with digital art, you know, you can just say, someone can just save your work and, you know, say like, no, that's mine. So it sort of provides a system where now you can authenticate digital art. It's, you know, it's never really happened before because it's hard to authenticate it. So, and because of that, it sort of puts digital artists in this spot where they're kind of forced to maybe like undervalue their work because of the fact that you can't authenticate it, right? So you'd sell your prints for like $10, $5 or whatever, because it's just copies, you know, like no one really has the original. So now, because of blockchain technology, we can now store, I can now store my art on a, you know, on the blockchain, you know, and with the blockchain, no one can delete it. It's public to everyone to see. Yeah. And also you can actually track how your art moves. So from one, so let's say someone collects an NFT from you, right? An NFT art piece from you, right? What's nice about it is that you can actually track when it moves from one wallet to another. So possibly from one collector to another. And also you get secondary sales. You know, I think with another, you know, issue I would see with physical art is that, you know, it's very difficult to know where it is, where your art lands up. So with NFTs, the minute your collector sells your work to another collector, you can actually earn secondary sales. So you can even set up what's called like a smart contract, where you can actually stipulate on the smart contract, which is also on the blockchain, I'm gonna get 15% of secondary sales each time it, obviously each time it moves. So like those kinds of things were things that really drew me into it. But I think more than anything was like us being able to authenticate our work, because also what that helped with is that because now I can, you know, confidently and safely say that you have the original, I can actually sell it or like give it to a collector at at its true value, you know, because with digital art, it's just a different kind of way of creating. But then this, it takes the same amount of effort, the same amount of experience and time to actually make the pieces. So,
What are some of the challenges you experienced with like trying to do NFTs?
There's been quite a number, but I think more than anything was being able to like filter information, because there's so much information about NFTs just in general. Like there's a lot of information on Google and stuff like that, so it becomes a little misleading and it becomes a little confusing, you know, to sort of like know what's true, what's not true, and just kind of understand, like, you know, just ask like what is an NFT and get like one simple answer. You see, so I think that was my main thing. So it took me a little bit of time. I think I took around 2 to 3 months just literally researching and trying to find out what NFTs exist, what are they, like, in a way that I can understand them, you know, because someone can explain it to you, but you won't really get it. You know, you kind of sometimes need to sort of go through a lot of information and then just find that one person that explains it in such a way that you actually get it. You know, then you get the aha moment, you know? Yeah. And that was one thing. The second thing was it's expensive. You know, it's expensive to be in the NFT community because we have something that's called gas fees. So how they work is every time you move an NFT, every time you actually put, or we call it mint, but every time you upload your artwork on the blockchain, you have to pay something that's called a gas fee, right? In any kind of cryptocurrency. So Ethereum, we've got Bitcoin, there's a lot of them now. But so I think like the money thing was a little bit of like an issue. It's just a little bit of like a barrier of entry. Also, even when you, like I said, when you have your work move from maybe your wallet to your collector's wallet, you know, you have to pay some kind of like transaction. And another thing with gas fees is that they fluctuate. Right, so they fluctuate based on how well or how horribly Ethereum or whatever currency you're using is doing. So I think those were the two things really. I think also in Africa, specifically South Africa, there's one extra step before you enter it in. So in terms of like your wallets, right? So we have a non-custodial wallet where you store your art, your NFTs, and your money, right? So that could be your Ethereum or whatever currency it is, right? Whatever cryptocurrency it is. But then with us, for us to convert our South African rands into Ethereum is one process, it's another extra process. So basically,
Sounds intense.
It is, essentially. So you'd have to get like a wallet called like a Luno wallet, basically. So where you would connect your bank account details to Luno, and then Luna will do that conversion for you. So then once you have your money, your cash in Ethereum, that's when you can move it to your non-custodial wallet and then have it, then you can use it for gas fees and stuff like that. So yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
It's very interesting though. It sounds like a different world altogether.
Yes.
But what gave you that, what confirmed that NFTs, because there's a lot of trends that come and go, but what gave you that confirmation that this is the right thing for you?
Honestly, it's not just about NFTs, it's about Web3, like Web3, because we are, as the world is moving into more of like a digital space. And I think, you know, so basically just what Web3 is basically we're moving into a space where now companies no longer own your data, right? Now with blockchain technology, your data is sort of like on the blockchain, meaning that everyone can like sort of see it and then it's free for everyone to use, right? So meaning that there won't be some kind of filtered down sort of like way of you receiving information through other companies, right? So so first, okay, let me put it this way. So first we had Web 1.0, right? Web 1.0 is back in the day where when you would go on the internet, it was just news. You couldn't interact with the news. So it was just like blogs, CNN and stuff like that. You just read the information. You couldn't interact with it. Then moved to Web 2.0, where now you had social media, right? So when you can now interact with the website, right? You can, you know, yeah, you can use Facebook, Instagram, stuff like that. So now Web 3.0 now allows you to protect your data, allows you to protect how, and also control how you see information, how you receive it, and the kind of information that you see, right? So it's no longer suggestions from a certain company, a certain social media page. You know, now it's free for all, basically. So But basically what really confirmed it for me was honestly like being able to authenticate my work, being able to say that you have the original digital art piece. So yeah.
And how many attempts did you have before, you know, you nailed it and said, you know, I can do this shit?
You know what? It was one. And I think I had gotten to a point where I was like, I'll never know until I try it. You know, I think that's another thing with NFTs. You can get so much information on it, but the best teacher is to just jump right into it and see what happens. So that's what happened. I just was like, you know what? I'm just going to do it and see what happens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what's the best collab you've done so far through NFT?
Through NFTs. I think Time Magazine was really great. That was really amazing. I think more than anything was just the people that are part of like we call the Time Piece community, but the Time Magazine community, like the other artists that were part of the group. You know, I think just the team behind it that are really like curating the entire project, that are curating all these artists, they are amazing people and they genuinely care about the people that are part of the community. And I think that's something that's so important. So honestly, that's been the best for me because of just honestly the kind of people that I've met and just how supportive, you know, they are. Yeah.
And how long did it take you for like time to even recognize you? How long did it take for you to get to that point within the space?
I joined the NFT like space in 2020, December 2020. That's when I minted my first piece. And then the Time thing came, I think, last year. And it was actually that's also another thing that I love about the space. It was through like a friend. It was through like someone that I had connected with because of NFTs. Like his name is Micah Johnson. And yeah, he's an ex football player, and then he just does like visual art now. And you know, we were connecting and just talking about like the plans that we both had for the space and the kind of work we wanted to do. And then we just kind of like always just kind of touched base here and there. And then he called me one day and he was like, hey, you know, here's an opportunity. You know, Time asked me to pick an artist and I think it'd be a great fit. And yeah, I was really, really grateful and happy for that. So that's how it happened, really. Yeah.
Shout out to him.
Yeah, shout out to Micah, man.
Where do you see yourself in the next future?
Honestly, I see myself like having deeper connections with other artists. Like I really want to connect with other artists and just collaborate with them on a much deeper level, not just, you know, talking about the things that we're working on, but like maybe possibly possible collaborations, you know, whether it is traditional artists or NFT artists.
Collaborations are a big thing for you. Why is that?
Honestly, they come to me most of the time.
Yeah.
But honestly, I think now I see the value of them. I think maybe that's why that it happened the way that it did, because I think I'm more of a person that's always to myself when I'm creating. So I think opportunities that came about where I actually had to work with people actually taught me the value of actually working with other artists, you know, learning about their disciplines and how they create. You know, it just always feels so, in a weird way, it always feels so validating to see another artist do the same thing that you're doing. It's like, you know what, I'm on the right track. You know, if this person can do it, I can do it. And just, you feel so inspired to see them doing that, you know, like to see them believing in art without a doubt and just doing that thing, you know. And I think that's something that really moves me.
Who are your top five female artists?
Top five women artists. I would say my number one always Caramel Poppy. Number two would be Alexis Franklin. She is a digital artist. Number three would be Zandile Chabalala. Love what she's doing right now in the space, in the art space. She's amazing. Number four, her number four and five is very tricky because I can't think of anyone at the
moment. Yeah. Who's your dream collaboration?
Caramel Poppy, without a doubt.
Yeah. Hey, hopefully that happens this year.
Hopefully.
So I asked you earlier about the challenges you faced as an NFT artist, but what are the challenges you faced as a young female artist in Africa? especially in South Africa?
Especially in South Africa. Mm. I would say a challenge that I've obviously faced as a woman are challenges that most women face when they're interacting with the other gender. But yeah, so I think that has just always been something that I think when you, as an artist or just as a woman, it doesn't matter what kind of industry you're in, you kind of have to put like some sort of layer of protection when you walk into a room, when you are working with you know, other men and things like that. So I would say that's been a challenge, just constantly being alert. You know, you can't let your guard down. And then I would say, just as an artist in Africa, wow, I would say that, like, just finding those opportunities. You know, I think now we are in an age where people share the experiences online. Like, you are connected to the entire world with just your phone, so you can actually see what other artists are exposed to, what other opportunities other artists are getting. And I think it's always been like sort of like a challenge to sort of like position yourself in such a way in which that you actually receive something similar to that, or get those kinds of opportunities. So I think just sort of connecting with the outside world, being in Africa, you know, something as simple as traveling can be an issue. You know, I think sometimes you'd love to collaborate with a specific company, brand, or whatever, but sometimes they'd need you to travel, sometimes they'd actually need to see your face, experience you, and I think you'd also need one to do the same as the artist. So I think just connecting with the outside world and being able to, you know, get those opportunities and connect with other people. Yeah.
And what advice would you give to a young artist that's planning to embark in the same journey that you're in right now?
I would honestly say that they must just do whatever they want to do in this space, honestly, in the art space. Like, create, like, stoned, be brave and courageous enough to create like exactly what's in your heart. Because something that is so interesting that I've been realizing in life is that sometimes you might be in a phase, in a creativity phase, where you kind of feel like it's not where you want it to be. But I think it's in those phases and stages that you learn a lot about yourself, and it's those things that actually lead you to becoming the kind of person you want to be. So I think, honestly, listen to your heart, and then just be brave enough to sort of translate whatever's in your heart on the paper.
Yeah. Wow, very wise. Do you think the artist industry is gender fluid?
I would say that I will just say that there is a lot more awareness now than I think there was back then. There are a lot more conversations around those kinds of things, and I think that is really good. We're off to a great start. Yeah.
What would your last meal be if it all ended today?
My last meal would be pizza.
Really?
Would be pizza. I'd say pizza, or it's a very weird, it would be pizza, or I'm not sure if you know mkhodu. I think it's called tripe.
Yes.
Love tripe with some pap.
I was expecting
one of
that.
The two.
I would rather have the other one than the pizza.
Right? Very homely, yeah. But it takes forever to cook, so
yeah, you'll be dead before you can even eat it.
Exactly.
Please don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And remember, we love getting feedback from you guys, so please continue showing us love, and feel free to give out any suggestions on how we can help improve this experience for you guys.